This is my homemade mill drill contraption, and I often use the scales on the hand cranks on this thing, the space holes precisely, but they're hard to read and they're inaccurate, so I'd like to have some kind of a digital readout.
And I experimented with using a rock and pinion and a magnetic rotary encoder to encode position, but not quite good enough. So my second cheapest option is to use two of these linear encoders, which go down to 0.01 millimeters, and they seem to work pretty good.
So the best place to sense side-to-side motion is on the back here, and if I bought a real DRO, I'd have a straight thing that goes on here, and another thing on here, and as the table moves side-to-side, this would pick it up. But what I bought instead is these things here, which the problem is both of these things mount on the flush surface. I could possibly flip this over like that. It's got the mounting screws on the back, but that means I have to screw from the inside, which I can't. So the screw holes on the back here are kind of useless because I can't mount it like that. And if it's on here like so, I'd need some kind of bracket that goes around to here. So all very awkward. I also don't want the chips falling into things, especially into here. So I realized if I extend the table back like this a little bit with a piece of wood, I can screw this to the underside of it. And then my mounting holes stick down to here, so I could have a block of wood on here that that attaches to. And that solves the problem. I just discovered recently what great center punches drywall screws make, because they're really hard and really pointy, and when they get dull, just grab another one. And then I switched to doing it horizontally so I don't have the chips falling down the hole. Now I've got this sensor screwed on from below, just on one end, so it has a little bit of wiggle in terms of lining itself up. And then that screws onto here, and I drilled the holes here. That was the best location, but very close to the edge here. So I didn't want to make these holes any bigger. So instead of using machine screws, I'm just going to screw those in with some drywall screws, because drywall screws will quite happily cut their own threads in mild steel or cast iron. I've actually already tapped a thread in there just by modifying a drywall screw before. And now I can just screw the drywall screw with the point cut off straight into the cast iron. So this part here now needs to attach up here, and I've got more room here than I thought I would, so I made this rather thick spacer that screws to the bottom here. Allow me to mount that so as the table moves, it moves my sensor. For the mounting holes for the front to back sensor, it was easiest to put the thing on its side on my drilling machine and drill the mounting holes there. And because I can adjust that machine to actually push down on the drill bit, I used it as a tap follower to tap the holes in there too. My side-to-side sensor is safely out of the way underneath this thing here, and for front and back, it's mounted on a mounting bracket right here, and this part here is actually mounted to the frame here. That was the easiest way to do it. I now have a digital readout of X and Y position, and I could call this done, but this isn't actually my end goal. And I already have some wires in there from when I worked out what the synchronous serial protocol is for getting the position out of it. Now I'm going to add some new wires, plus wires for power. Still works. So now I have both of these running off some AAA batteries with a physical switch to turn them on. And the reason these things use two-button cells is because even when they're off, they draw about 30 microamps, which is enough to drain one of those button cells after 300 days. And the reason they use two of these batteries is just so that it takes longer, so you get about 1.6 years before the battery drains, even with the thing off. Turning this thing on actually only increases the current to 40 microamps, so basically, the on-off button only turns the display on and off. And I also brought out the digital signals which go onto this connector, and I can plug this cable onto here and run that to a computer to decode the positions from both of these things. The thing is, though, if you physically turn them off, they actually do lose their position.
It's just like these digital calipers, which somehow magically remember their position, even if you turn them off. They don't really, it's just they don't actually turn off. So if I pop the battery out and put it back in, now it doesn't remember the position.
And that's why these things always run out of battery, even if you're not using them. And my next step was to read the position into my Raspberry Pi computer. And I've used a real DRO before, and dialing in a position by looking at the numbers, really annoying. So I wrote this program, which shows a crosshair for where my table is at, plus the positions where I actually want to drill a hole, so I can just crank that to line it up to hit those positions in X and Y. I even have a zoomed in view that allows me to line up really precisely.
For my first test, I'm going to drill a 7-hole bolt circle, hopefully precisely. And then another one to mate with the one I just made.
And that should match a bolt circle the same size perfectly. And it does. And if I rotate that 1/7 of a turn, it should still fit. Yep. So these were very precisely drilled.
As for the position encoding format coming out of these things, it's actually just a synchronous serial. Blue line is clock, yellow is data. Had me very confused initially because I was just looking at the data line, and some of these clock pulses are longer, so that seemed really weird.
And I just bit-banged that from Python and a Raspberry Pi 3. Plenty fast. It misses some pulses from time to time, but it detects that and doesn't use those readings. And then my code for doing all the plotting is this. Not very much to it either.
And I actually experimented with getting ChatGPT to write that graphics code, and it was very quick at producing a usable starting point. But then refining the code, telling it to fix this and fix that, quite often I told it to fix one thing and it would re-break another thing. And looking at the code, I didn't really like the design of it, so I actually had to give ChatGPT a detailed design of what I wanted it to be, as in write a routine that does this and write a routine that does that. And in the end, at some point, I just sort of took a version from ChatGPT and ended up refining that myself, because that way at least I know how it works and I don't have it breaking it every time I fix something else.
And I mounted these up here now. Shouldn't have done that.
And I've been questioning my sanity doing all of this, but there's times that these would have been handy in the past, even without a computer hooked up to them.